this Mother's Day 2020, I felt the best call to worship would be Proverbs 31. Solomon writes, "Who can find a virtuous wife? For her worth is far above rubies. The heart of her husband safely trusts her, so he will have no lack of gain. She does him good and not evil all the days of her life. She seeks wool and flax and willingly works with her hands. She is like the merchant ships. She brings her food from afar. She also rises while it is yet night and provides food for her household and a portion for her maidservants. She considers a field and buys it. From her profit, she plants a vineyard. She girds herself with strength and strengthens her arms. She perceives that her merchandise is good, and her lamp does not go out by night. She stretches out her hands to the distaff, and her hands hold the spindle. She extends her hand to the poor. Yes, she reaches out her hands to the needy. She is not afraid of snow, for her household, for all her household is clothed with scarlet. She makes tapestry for herself. Her clothing is fine linen and purple. Her husband is known in the gates when he sits among the elders of the land. She makes him linen garments and sells them and supplies sashes for the merchants. Strength and honor are her clothing. She shall rejoice in time to come. She opens her mouth with wisdom, and on her tongue is the law of kindness. She watches over the ways of her household and does not eat the bread of idleness. Her children rise up and call her blessed, her husband also, and he praises her. Many daughters have done well, but you excel them all. Charm is deceitful and beauty is passing, but a woman who fears the Lord, she shall be praised. Give her of the fruit of her hands and let her own works praise her in the gates." Let us open with a word of prayer. Gracious Heavenly Father, once again, as we gather this morning, we may not be able to be here physically in this place, but Lord, we know that your church is the body of Christ. Those who know you as Lord and Savior, no matter where they are one with you and one with one another. We praise and thank you, Lord, for mothers. We are so grateful, Lord, for how they have touched our lives, how they've had an impact in making us who we are today. Again, Lord, this is a day when we would honor mothers, and certainly it is a day that we think of them often. Now, Lord, as we open this service today, we pray that it will be a blessing. It will reach out and touch lives and change lives and be such an important part of this day as we celebrate what mothers mean to each and every one of us. So we ask your blessing on this service, and we ask it in our Savior's most precious name. Amen. As we open this morning, we would be singing hymn number 1, "Joyful, Joyful, We Adore Thee."
Thank you.
Thank you, Daisy. Regarding announcements, again, very few things are happening right now, but let me say that yesterday and this past week has been a true blessing to both my wife, Marianne, and myself. Yesterday, we were here at the church for a couple of hours, and we were handing out the elements for communion, and while, again, we cannot gather together to celebrate communion, we will have a communion service at the close of the service today. It was so good to see so many of our members come by to pick up their kits, and we had a word with each one. It's good to know that everyone in our congregation continues to do well. We have no reported cases of the COVID, and the result is that we truly are thankful for the Lord. Also, this week I had a real blessing to talk with one of our members who's gone through a very serious medical procedure, and he is doing well, and he's praising the Lord for that as well. So we just thank the Lord for how much he is touching lives. This is Mother's Day, and certainly it is a day that where we honor our mothers, and typically at this point in time, we would have all the mothers in our church stand. We would recognize them for all that they've done in the raising of children, and not only physical mothers, but spiritual mothers as well. Many mothers have had the opportunity to be part of leading someone to Christ and being able to then disciple them and bring them along and see them grow in maturity and in the spiritual life. And so at that time, we would then pass out the flowers to the mothers and also a small recognition gift for them as well. Unfortunately, we can't do that. And I stop and think of my own mother. She went home to be with the Lord almost 5 years ago. I had the opportunity to visit with her just 3 weeks before she did pass away. She lived in Florida and was in a nursing home, and so I did have that opportunity to see her. And I think of my mother that for most of her life, she was a stay-at-home mom. She raised four children. I'm the oldest, and then my brother is the youngest, and he's 16 years younger than I am. But in her early 50s, my mother felt a challenge to do something. She went to nursing school, earned her RN, and then went to work as a nurse. And again, to see how the Lord works in people's lives is amazing. Because shortly after she received her RN degree, my brother graduated from high school, and just a week after that, my dad died and went home to be with the Lord. So at that time, my mother then spent the next few years raising my brother, helping my brother get through college, and then seeing him get married, and then shortly after, she as well went on and was remarried. So I thought about what that meant to me, and I found this poem. It is by Herbert Farnham, and it's entitled, God's Masterpiece is Mother. It says, God took the fragrance of a flower, the majesty of a tree, the gentleness of morning dew, the calm of quiet sea, the beauty of the twilight hour, the soul of a starry night, the laughter of a rippling brook, the grace of a bird in flight. Then God fashioned from these things a creation like no other, and when his masterpiece was through, he called it simply Mother. So let me encourage you that if your mom is still alive, and if you're not able to see her today, call her on the phone. Just tell her what she means to you and how she's changed your life. I know that I am the man I am and the man I have been all my life because of many of the things that my mother had impacted in my own life. In this morning's message, I would invite you to take your Bibles and turn to Genesis, the first book of the Bible, Genesis chapter 16. And we'll be looking at also Genesis chapter 21, but we'll start in Genesis chapter 16. And on this Mother's Day, I would like for us to consider a woman that we probably pay very little attention to. Her name is Hagar. And we're going to look at it from the perspective of Hagar, the crying mother. Hagar and her mistress, Sarah, their stories are intertwined from the very beginning, and they overlap with one another again and again. But Hagar's story is especially touching, since it reminds us of how God comforts mothers in times of sorrow. There are a number of verses in the book of Proverbs that we read and speak about the wise child bringing joy to his father, but most of the time it talks about the foolish child bringing grief to the mother. And it's always put that way, not the other way around. And we wonder, why would God emphasize this, that child is related to grief, when he speaks about the mother? And I believe it's because God puts in the heart of a mother a special love for the child. They carry that child for 9 months. That child is close to them. They feel every kick and every movement of the child throughout that 9 month period. And then when the child is born, there was so much involved again with the mother. And it's not that fathers don't grieve as well over a child, but I believe that God has that special heart of compassion for mothers who really grieve. My prayer this morning for this message is this, that each of us will gain an understanding, a better understanding and a better appreciation and an empathy for mothers and the sorrow they bear. And I hope that we will be drawn into the ability to praise God for what mothers do and what mothers will continue to do, and how in God's great compassion and care that as mothers, they learn to trust God in every situation, and they trust God to take their children and have only the best for them as they move forward into the future. Now let me say that as long as there has been mothers, there have been tears. Mothers carry a special burden for their children. As parents, we love our children. And certainly in my own case, I've had the great privilege of having a daughter, and she'll be 50 years old come December. And we've watched her every step of her life from the moment she took that first step to even today as she's bringing up her own children. And they bring us such joy, but sometimes they also bring us pain. And this is the case that we find Hagar in our stories today. There's three truths about God that I want you to take away from this message this morning. And these are the three truths that we find. First of all, that God sees us in our pain. Secondly, that God hears us in our distress. And thirdly, that God loves us and has a plan for each and every one of us. And even though I may be talking specifically about mothers this morning, I believe these three things apply to each and every one of us who have a deep relationship with God. So let's begin this morning. God sees us in our pain. And we'll be looking at the first 16 verses of Genesis chapter 16. And as we do, we see that God is not a God who just wound up this world and set it in motion and then went away to some distant place and has nothing to do with us. God is a God who is deeply involved with each and every one of us. He cares intimately about everything that's happening in our lives, and God sees us even in those times of pain that we experience. In the first three verses here, we see that God sees somebody in their pain, and as he does, he recognizes that there are times in our life where things happen to us that we have absolutely no control over whatsoever. It may be a job situation where all of a sudden, as we've seen so recently, where companies close and people are tossed out of work with no opportunity to have a moment to even look for another job. There may be no jobs available. In other cases, it may be an illness that comes along and people are just not able to even deal with that illness. But whatever it may be, something happens and it is totally out of our control. And that's what we see in the case of Hagar here. It starts off in verse 1 of Genesis 16. It says, "Now Sarai, Abram's wife, had borne him no children, and she had an Egyptian maidservant whose name was Hagar. So Sarai said to Abram, 'See now, the Lord has restrained me from bearing children. Please go into my maid. Perhaps I shall obtain children by her.' And Abram heeded the wife of Sarai. Then Sarai, Abram's wife, took Hagar, her maid, the Egyptian, and gave her to her husband, Abram, to be his wife, after Abram had dwelt 10 years in the land of Canaan." Here in chapter 16 is the very first time that we meet Hagar. Abraham, prior to that, had gone down into Egypt. He was leaving Canaan to escape a great famine. And while he was there, he accumulated great sheep, herds, and flocks. And the result was that Sarah had even acquired this maid by the name of Hagar. So here's Hagar. She's an Egyptian handmaid. She is far from home. She has been uprooted from her homeland, separated from her family, and now forced to do the bidding of another. And that's certainly having no control over your life whatsoever. But it even gets worse, because now we see that Abram is going to get involved and Sarah is getting involved in her life in a very intimate way. We look at Sarah and the Bible tells us very clearly, she could have no children. How long she and Abraham were married, we don't know. But for many, many years, they waited and waited for a child and none came. So she decides that she's going to use Hagar to build a family for herself. And so she says to Abram, "Take my handmaid, Take her to be your wife, and maybe she will bear children, and they will be mine. Now, we may be appalled at that kind of a situation, but in the Old Testament days, that was something that was a common practice. God never condoned it. God didn't design it. God never suggested it or approved it, but he did regulate it. God's design, as we know, for marriage there in Genesis chapter 2 is one man, one woman, forever. They come together, they're joined for all eternity, and that's God's perfect plan. But as we look at it, we know that certainly people have multiple wives. And in most cases, multiple wives cause multiple problems. Look at what happened to poor Jacob after he wanted just one wife. He had set his heart on having Rebekah for his wife. And what happens? By mistake, he gets the wrong, or not by mistake, but by the devious plan of his uncle Laban, he gets a different wife. And then he gets a second wife, and then a third wife, and a fourth wife. And we know the result of that was there was so much infighting within the sons that were born to these four different wives that by the time his favorite came along, Joseph, there was just problem after problem after problem. And so the same's going to happen with Hagar and Abram and Sarah. So God sees us in our pain. God sees us when we feel that we have no control over our life. God also sees us when others mistreat us. Continuing on, look at what it says in verses 4 through 6. It says, so he, that being Abram, went into Hagar, and she conceived. And when she saw that she had conceived, her mistress became despised in her eyes. Then Sarai said to Abram, my wrong be upon you. I gave my maid into your embrace, and when she saw that she had conceived, I became despised in her eyes. The Lord judge between you and me. So Abram said to Sarai, indeed, your maid is in your hand. Do to her as you please. And when Sarai dealt harshly with her, she fled from her presence. Well, look at the whole situation now. The plan that initially Sarai had come up with had worked out perfectly. Her maid is conceived, she's going to have a child, and through that child, then Abraham's line will be continued. But the result of it is that all of a sudden, Hagar turns the tables around. Hagar becomes pregnant, and she doesn't handle things very well. The Bible tells us she despised her mistress. Somehow now she felt better than Sarai, and she probably lorded it over her, that here I am, I'm able to bear a child for your husband when you couldn't. Then you look at Sarah. And how does she handle things? Well, she doesn't handle things very well either. The first thing she does is she points her finger at Abraham and says it's all your fault. Poor Abraham was probably standing there shaking his head thinking, how did I get into this mess? And sometimes that's what happens to us. We find ourselves in a situation that we never thought we'd ever find. And then look at Abraham. He doesn't handle things well either. All three of them handle things in a very poor way. Abraham wants to just take his hands off and says, Sarah, that's your problem. You deal with her as you will. And so what does the Bible say? It says that Sarah mistreats Hagar. And the result is that Hagar runs away. And here she is, an expected mother, running away from the only home that she knows now at this point in time. She's now in Canaan, and she's thinking about going all the way back to Egypt. And it's interesting that when we look at Hagar's name, her name actually means flight or wanderer. And so certainly she takes flight from Sarah. Now, if we stop for a few minutes, we might say, well, a lot of the problem that Hagar is experiencing has been brought on by herself. If she hadn't despised Sarah, maybe Sarah wouldn't have mistreated her. But Sarah was still in the wrong. And Hagar still felt the pain of being mistreated by another person. You know, in some ways, it's good news for us that Hagar was partly to blame. Because what that says to us is that even when we have contributed to our own pain or our own problem, God still sees us and cares for us. Then verses 7 down through verse 16. And that brings us to the third point of the section, that God sees us in our pain and he intervenes. God doesn't just stand off and watch, but he comes to the aid of Hagar. Verses 7 through 10, it says, now the angel of the Lord found her by a spring of water in the wilderness by the spring on the way to Shur. And he said, Hagar, Sarah's maid, where have you come from and where are you going? She said, I am fleeing from the presence of my mistress Sarah. The angel of the Lord said to her, return to your mistress and submit yourself under her hand. Then the angel of the Lord said to her, I will multiply your descendants exceedingly so that they shall not be counted for a multitude. All of a sudden, a new person enters the scene. We have Abraham, we have Sarah, we have Hagar. And now we meet another individual called the angel of the Lord. And the angel of the Lord in the New Testament was typically a messenger from God. But in this particular case, he also speaks for God, and he acts in the place of God because he actually makes a promise to Hagar. And so he's a representative for God, and in some ways he's God himself. The angel of the Lord finds Hagar near a spring in the desert. She or she is on her way to Shur. And if we look at the road that's on the way to Shur, what it is it's heading west. She's heading back to Egypt. Her plan is that she's going home. She's trying to get all the way back to Egypt. But look at her situation. She's pregnant with a child. She's in the desert. She's trying to cross the desert by herself. And probably she's not going to make it home. She's in great pain. And she's in great need. But God sees her in her pain, and what does he do? He comes and he intervenes in this particular situation. And he sends his angel to her in the desert, and notice what he says. Hagar, servant of Sarai, where have you come from, and where are you going? Notice, this angel is able to address her by name. Throughout the entire narrative, both Abraham and Sarah have only called her a servant. Or a maidservant. It's as if Hagar was never a real person to them. But God sees her as a person, and God calls her by name. And I think that's one of the most interesting things we learn about God, is that God knows each and every one of us in an intimate way. God created you, God loves you, and God knows you. He knows every detail about your life. And he sees you in your pain, and when he sees you in your pain, he comes and he intervenes. But notice also what the angel said. He says, Hagar, servant of Sarai, whether Hagar likes it or not, whether it's right or not, this is her current situation. And God doesn't sugarcoat the reality. You're a servant. You're a maidservant. That's your role in life. But he also asked an interesting question. I love as I read it, it says, where have you come from and where are you going? Well, we know where she's come from. She's come from a situation of pain. She's running away from that pain, and she's trying to get to Egypt. But she's not running towards something as much as she's running away from something. And oftentimes, that's the same situation we find ourselves in. We get into a situation that we find is intolerable. We get into a situation that we say, this is unacceptable to me, and the first thing we want to do is we want to run away from it. But that's not always the case. And we'll see that instead of running away from something, God wants us moving towards something. And God makes sure that he tells Hagar that he has a plan for her. And that plan is going to come through her son. Because he says to her, he makes a promise. And he says, you shall have a son, and I will multiply your descendants exceedingly. He says, you are going to have more descendants than you can ever imagine. And you know, God asks us that same question. He says, where are you going? And where are you come from? And where are you going? When we're in pain, we probably know the answer to that question. You know, we know where we're going, where we're coming from, but we might not know where we're going. And that's the key. Notice what God says. Go back. Go back to the place of pain. Go back to the difficult situation you found her in. And God tells her that he has a plan for both her and her son. So God answers the question, where are you going? And then look at verses 11 through verse 14. He says, and the angel of the Lord said to her, behold, you are with child, and you shall bear a son. You shall call his name Ishmael, because the Lord has heard your affliction. He shall be a wild man. His hand shall be against every man, and every man's hand against him. And he shall dwell in the presence of all of his brethren. Then she called the name of the Lord who spoke to her, you are the God who sees. For she said, have I also here seen him who sees me? Therefore, the well was called Beer Lahai-Roi. Notice, it is between Kadesh and Beered. When the angel of the Lord came to Hagar, he addressed her by name. And he said, Hagar. Now, Hagar gives God a name. And the name she gives him is so great. She says, you are the God who sees me. That tells us she's had a relationship now with God. There's a connection there between the two. And that's how it should be with us as well. We should recognize that God always sees us. Whatever our situation may be, wherever we may find ourselves, God's eyes are upon us. Many, many years ago, I can remember George Beverly Shea used to sing at the Billy Graham. And one of the songs he always sang was, "His eye is on the sparrow." Well, if God's eyes are on the sparrow, we know his eyes are on me as well. And that's what Hagar says. He is the one who sees me. And then they give a name to the well that she finds herself sitting beside as well. They call it Beer Lahai-Roi. And that really means the well of the living one who sees me. So she connects the well with God. And then notice what it says. She went back. It says, Hagar obeys God, and she returned to Sarai. Verse 15 and 16. So Hagar bore Abraham a son, and Abraham gave the name Ishmael to the son she had born. Abraham was 86 years old when Hagar bore him Ishmael. So Hagar goes, she returns to Sarai, she submits herself again to be a servant, and as she does, she has a child. But what we see is that this child, while it brought a delight to Abraham, is going to bring a lot of pain, and there will be conflict between Hagar and Sarah, as well as between their sons and as well as their descendants, even down to this day. And in spite of all this, God's plan continued to move forward. So that's the first thing we learn about Hagar, the crying mother, that God sees us in our pain. When we feel like our life is out of control, when others mistreat us, God sees us in our pain, and he intervenes. And then secondly, God sees us in our distress. 14 years pass. Very little is said about those 14 years. In Genesis 21, we find a second incident recorded about Hagar. A lot has happened in those 14 years. And we see that God has changed Abram's name to Abraham. He's changed Sarai's name to Sarah. Sarah has given birth to the promised child, Isaac, and it's that birth that triggers the next incident in the life of Hagar. And here we see that God sees us in our distress, even when our children have caused us that distress. We mentioned earlier that being a mother brings great joy, but at the same time, it can also bring great sorrow. Think of it. Here is one of Hagar's sorrows as a mother, and that's when distress is caused by her son. Verses 8 through 13 say this from Genesis 21. So the child Isaac grew and was weaned. And Abraham made a great feast on the same day that Isaac was weaned. And Sarah saw the son of Hagar, the Egyptian, whom she had borne to Abraham, scoffing. Therefore she said to Abraham, cast out this bondwoman and her son, for the son of this bondwoman shall not be heir with my son, namely with Isaac. And the matter was very displeasing in Abraham's sight because of his son. But God said to Abraham, do not let it be displeasing in your sight because of the lad or because of your bondwoman. Whatever Sarah has said to you, listen to her voice. For in Isaac your seed shall be called. Yet I will also make a nation of the son of the bondwoman because he is your seed. So Isaac is finally born. It was 25 years after Abraham entered the land of promise. He had left Ur of the Chaldees 25 years before. God had called him there from that godless nation, and he said, I'm going to bring you to a land that you do not know. And he led him all the way there. And when he got into the land, God made promises to him. And those promises were, he says, I will make of you a great nation. He says, I will give you a great land. And he says, I'm going to make you a great blessing. And we know that eventually, through the line of Abraham, eventually came the birth of Jesus Christ, the greatest blessing to all the world. And it tells us now that Isaac is born, the child of promise, the child of Sarah. Abraham was 99 years old. Sarah was 89 years old. Each of them were well past being able to conceive and have children. But God intervenes in a miraculous way, and this child is born. And so the time comes, and Abraham holds this great feast. He calls all of his servants together and all of the people together. But something happens. And what happens is this, is that Ishmael mocks Isaac at the feast. And Sarah becomes so incensed at what takes place that she goes to Abraham and says, cast them out. And Abraham loved Ishmael. It's been 14 years. So he's had this opportunity to love this boy, watch him grow, probably had taught him all the things that a typical father would teach a son. And now his wife says, cast them out. Send them away. And he doesn't know what to do. And then God comes to him and he says, listen to what Sarah says. Send them away. And what that meant was that they were going to be disinherited. If they had stayed in the camp, if she had stayed there with Abraham, then Ishmael would share in the inheritance. And by, again, custom, as the firstborn, he would have received twice as much as Isaac would have received. So they are disinherited. They're sent away. Hagar and Ishmael had every legal right to stay and to be heirs of Abraham. Now, as we look at this, we'd have to say that Abraham and Sarah are both doing them wrong. But poor Hagar, this is not her fault. This time it's her son that causes the distress. And sometimes we find that our children do cause us distress and pain. So what happens when that occurs? When our distress brings us to tears, we know that still God still hears, even when our children cause us that distress. Look at verses 14 through 16. It says, so Abraham arose early in the morning and took bread and a skin of water, and putting it on her shoulder, he gave it and the boy to Hagar and sent her away. Then she departed and wandered in the wilderness of Beersheba, and the water in the skin was used up, and so she placed the boy under one of the shrubs. Then she went and sat down across from him, a distance of about a bow shot, for she said to herself, let me not see the death of the boy. So she sat opposite him and lifted up her voice and wept. What a heartbreaking picture this is. Here is Sarah, poor Egyptian slave, all alone in the desert. She had a skin of water and a small amount of food. And very quickly, the water ran out. If you've ever been in the Middle East, when it gets to high noon, it gets hot in the desert. It's up 120, 130 degrees. The sun beating down, there's very little shade. The shrub bush is probably nothing more than something that the boy could crawl under for the least bit of shade he could find. And here is Hagar. She's out of water. She's out of options. She's out of hope. So she puts Ishmael under the bush. She sits a distance from him, and she waits for him to die. And as she does, the Bible tells us she breaks down and weeps. But again, God hears the weeping, and God intervenes. When we find ourselves in distress, when we find ourselves in a situation that brings us to tears, we can know that God hears us, and he will intervene. Verses 17 through 19, it says, and God heard the voice of the lad. Then the angel of the Lord came to Hagar out of heaven, and said to her, what ails you, Hagar? Fear not, for God has heard the voice of the lad where he is. Arise, lift up the lad and hold him with your hand, for I will make him a great nation. Then God opened her eyes, and she saw a well of water. And she went and filled the skin with water and gave the lad a drink. God hears both Hagar and Ishmael crying. And he intervenes again. And notice what happens. The first thing he does, he assures her. He says, don't fear. Fear not. All the things that you're thinking that could happen, they're not going to happen. And then he reassures her or reaffirms his promise. He probably wanted to say to her, 14 years ago, I told you that nothing was going to happen to the boy. 14 years ago, I told you this boy would become the father of a great nation. So many people, you couldn't count them. What are you crying for? And then again, he provides them water in the desert. He opens her eyes. Before that, she was blind. But now he opens her eyes. And she sees the well. And it says, she drinks and the boy drinks. And we know the rest of the story is this. Ishmael grew up. He married. He had children. God took this dying boy under a bush there in the desert. And he made him a great nation. All because he heard a mother crying. Finally, God loves us, and he has a plan for us. The lesson to all of us is how much God really loves us. Jeremiah 29:11 says this, for I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you and not to harm you, plans to give you hope and a future. He could have said those words to Hagar right there as she was sitting and crying over the death or expected death of her son. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you hope in the future. Now, this verse here in Jeremiah gives us two wonderful truths. The first one is this: God knows the plans he has for us. Certainly, as we grow and mature in life, and we look at the future, none of us knows what the future holds for us. 6 months ago, none of us in this world would have ever thought we would be in the situation we are today. Again, as I said, yesterday, as I talked to each group of each car that came up to pick up their communion elements, the one question I asked over and over again was this: when are we going to get back into church? When can we gather together to worship? And we don't know. We just don't know. But God does. And when it's time, he will bring us back together. So he knows. And it's the same thing. God asks us another question: where have you come from? And where are you going? Well, we may not know the answer to that question either, but God does. Who would know from one day to the next what can happen to us? What I do know is this: he wants us to learn to trust in him, because he sees the future, he knows the future, and he has a plan for each and every one of us. And even in our distress, even in our pain, he is there and he sees us, just as he said to Hagar. And what he wants us to do is Proverbs 3, 5, and 6. Trust in the Lord with all your heart, and lean not unto your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge him, and he will make your paths straight. And then the second truth that we see here in Jeremiah is this: God will give you hope and a future. God has already intervened. Look at what God has done 2,000 years ago. He sent his only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, into this world to be our Savior. Jesus died on the cross for our sins so that we could be forgiven and restored to a relationship with God. And when we put our faith in Jesus Christ, the promise that God gives us is right there in Romans 8, 28. We know that in all things God causes them to be good for us who love him, for we have been called according to his purpose. Motherhood involves sacrifices. Every mother hurts when she sees her children hurt. We make mistakes. Our children make mistakes. And sometimes those mistakes lead to even greater sorrows. But through it all, God is there. We are not alone. God sees us in our pain. God hears us in our distress. God loves us and has a plan for us and for our children. We can bring our sorrows to him. We can pray for our children. God will give us hope and a future. I would venture to say this morning this: that there has never been a mother on earth who has not shed tears. But the Bible tells us that one day God himself will wipe away our tears. We read in Revelation 21, God himself will be with them and be their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death or mourning or crying or pain. I can tell you this: a beautiful future awaits those who trust in Jesus Christ. Every wound will be healed. Every pain will be removed. Every tear will be dried. And crying mothers will cry no more. Would you pray with me? Heavenly Father, once again, as we think of mothers, each one of us came into this world by a mother. Each one of us were nurtured and loved and cared for by our mothers. And probably every one of us brought tears to our mother's eyes at some point in life. But certainly we know too that our mothers loved us. They kept loving us, and they loved us right to the very end. And we praise and thank you for that this morning in Jesus' name. Amen. As we prepare for our communion, we're going to sing Fill My Cup, Lord, hymn number 398. And as he took this bread again, he said, "This is my body, which is broken for you." And in a very short time, his hands would be nailed to a cross, his feet would be nailed to a cross. The Romans would lift that cross up and drop it into its place. And Jesus would then hang there, bearing the sins of the world. And people would come by and they would mock. Others, it says, his mother and others stood by and wept. They thought everything had ended. But Jesus, as he hung there, was bearing the sins of the earth, the sins of the world, every sin that was ever committed, every sin that would be ever committed. And the wrath of God was poured out on him so that we didn't have to experience it. So he says to his disciples, "Take, eat in remembrance of me." And then the Bible says he took the cup, and over each element he prayed over it. And as he did, it was so important for them to understand what he was doing. But the disciples, I don't think they had a clue at that time, but they would know later on after the Holy Spirit came upon them. So let us stop for a moment and thank again God for the gift of his Son, Jesus Christ. Heavenly Father, we do thank you for the body and blood of Jesus Christ. And Lord, as we feed upon these elements, again, we know that they are symbolic of all that took place on that night. And it's a time for us to remember the perfect life that Jesus lived, the fact that he came at just the right time, the fact that he lived for 3.5 years revealing your love to this world. And then, Lord, your wrath fell upon him, fell upon all the sins of the world, so that we didn't have to experience it. That's how important it was for Christ as he went to the cross, because he wanted us not to have to bear your wrath. God loves us so very much, and we thank you for that. So it says he took the cup, and as he did, he began to pass it to his disciples. And he said to them, "Take, drink, do this in remembrance of me." And as we close our communion service, we would all stand here in the sanctuary. We would reach out to one another, hold hands. Well, in this day of social distancing, that's not possible. But in your own home, wherever you are, whether you're watching it live streaming or if you're watching this on DVD, if there's someone else there in your home, take their hand, hold on to it, and just know that God loves both of you, even where you are, even in this very moment. So let us sing, "I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God." Shine upon you this day and in the days ahead until we can once again meet together and celebrate and praise our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ as one. Thank you so much for watching, and God bless you this day.